kids like him, we need a hero. I believe there's a hero in all of us that keeps us honest, gives us strength, makes us noble, and finally allows us to die with pride. Even though sometimes we have to be steady and give up the thing we want the most.
Pete, look, you're changing. I know I went through exactly the same thing at your age.
No, not exactly.
Peter, these are the years when a man changes into the man he's going to become the rest of his life. Just be careful who you change into. Remember, with great power comes great responsibility. This is my gift. My curse. Who am I?
You told Oprah Winfrey you're a new black. And I just wonder what you mean by that.
Well, it was
again, a lot of people have been wondering what you mean. And
well, no,
it's
just
black if you're a new black.
Well, no, I can't point to anybody else. The only thing I can tell you is, you know, my experience in being black is that, like, I love what I do, I love who I am, and I make no excuses for what I look like and what that means to me. But I don't, you know, I use my mind for my opportunities. I'm not looking for anyone's help because of my skin color. I don't see, you know, my skin color as some affliction or something that holds me back in the world. I am proud of my skin color, and at the end of the day, anything that I do, I celebrate who I am, and I celebrate what my mom and dad made, and that is a new way of looking at my life. But can I speak for a whole entire culture? No, I can't.
What? Huh? I'll be that. I don't know who I am. Aww. Well, I'll be an Alabama punch monkey's uncle. At least you know who you is. Years ago, I married a widow who had a grown-up daughter. My daddy visited us often, fell in love, and married her. Thusly, he became my son-in-law, and my stepdaughter became my mother because she was my father's wife. That's right. After that, my father's wife gave birth to a son, which became my brother and my grandchild because he's the son of my daughter.
You jiving?
I ain't jiving. Now, accordingly, my wife was my grandmother because she was my mother's mother. Man, 10, I was my wife's husband and grandchild at one and the same time. And lo and behold, as the husband of a person's grandmother is a grandfather,
that's right,
I became my goddamn own grandfather. Oh, holy mackerel!
Sweet and eat that
show is a whopper. You city cousin. Oh, yes.
You know the tape of that? When people started putting videos around the world of themselves getting happy.
You ain't never seen no niggas stand here with a fiddle. You ain't never seen no niggas that stand here playing on no fiddle. You ain't never seen no niggas like this that stand here playing on the fiddle. You ain't seen no niggas like this that getting down on the fiddle. Watch it now.
You couldn't hold out any longer, could you?
So funny, man.
Come
on, man.
Funny, man.
That shit is funny to me, son.
You funny
to me.
Find
that shit funny.
Watch it now.
Makes me cry, too. Makes me cry, too.
No.
Hey, how's y'all doing? This is Mr. Blows Your Mind coming with another thought-provoking topic. Today's topic, black. And what is this new black? I'm going to say that again. Black. And what is this new black? Well, the reason why I'm bringing this, y'all, is because I'm not going to say that I'm late on it. I wanted to, you know, what I do is I let things marinate and let people get out what they have to say when it initially comes out. That way I can get a little bit more information, a little bit more insight as into what is in detailed in this story. So I caught the news flash of the Oprah and Pharrell interview. And based on that interview, you know, I was kind of, you know, appalled at some of the things he stated. Now, at the beginning of this video, you see that I put in the clip of the of Spider-Man. And the reason why I use the Spider-Man aspect of it is not because, you know, I'm trying to depict whiteness. What it was is what was said. Now, with great powers come great responsibility. And what I want to do with this video here, and for those who consider themselves to be new black, I want to pose some insight to you historically as well as informationally as into why I believe that many of you have come with this notion that you are separating yourself from black. I'm not going to say old black, because there ain't no such thing. It's either black or non-black. You feel what I'm saying? New black means that you were some kind of new crayon. You know what I'm saying? It's like saying going to Crayola. They got a box of 64 in a pack. Remember back in the day, we had the 64 pack of crayons in the pack? Well, what the new blacks are trying to do is telling Crayola to create a new black. You know how like they have different variations of green, lime green, you feel what I'm saying, a burnt orange, you know what I'm saying, a red violet. Well, they're trying to come up with a new kind of black. You feel what I'm saying? And so I believe, to me, the psychological aspect that is happening, that has been permeating our children, are now starting to fruition, as now it is becoming this wedge between one aspect of our people versus another aspect, who seem to think that they thought, what I think that they think is that they come up with the blueprint. They saying, wow, all you had to do is do this and look how we're gaining. If they truly believe that. But see, videos like this are necessary. Again, I'm going to say, you know, I hate the fact that sometimes some of this stuff has to be put out here that is open to the public. It's kind of like giving you a sneak peek into some of the conversations or some of the thought process that a lot of us are having. And for me, I don't have a problem. You can hear me all day long. You feel what I'm saying? I am what you call nigritude. Look it up, right? That's pride. You know, when you look at this Pharrell interview, not the one with Oprah, but originally it was with Oprah, but it was with this other interview. I wasn't sure what this cat's name is, but I broke down because I replayed it in the clip, right? So let's look at this, and then I'll get back to some of the other points I was talking about, why I believe that this new black and why this mindset, and I'm going to take you historically into the psychological effects and why you are coming out and you are, you know, you are vehemently saying these things as if it's like, you know, you're stiff-arming your connection of your people as if you are something separate. And the reason why you're separating yourself, we're going to find out why you are trying to separate yourself. Now, when you look at that Pharrell interview, what I did is I broke it down and I looked at it and I studied what he said. Okay? Now, what he said is a lot of individual individualness to himself. All about me. My. I. Am. You feel what I'm saying? This is the individual aspect. Where does this individual aspect come from? It is not an African thought process. We always talked about communal, community, togetherness. This individualness about what I do and what other people and how I have no ties to what I do affects any of them. See, where did you get this mindset from? You feel what I'm saying? How do you feel so comfortable to say that you know that if you're in an industry that is very influential and you say, use the word culture, and you feel if I say something that is my opinion, that my opinion will not affect the people who hear me, who look up to me, who idolize me, who are influenced by what I do, and you think you can just walk away as if to say, well, this is my opinion. When you speak for a lot of other people unseen. You feel what I'm saying? Unheard. Those who idolize and try to mimic you. So you have to be careful about what you are saying. Otherwise, don't do interviews if you are unconscious. You feel what I'm saying? So one, he says he couldn't point to anyone else. Right? When he initially says, well, I couldn't point to anyone else. Meaning, I'm not going to point out anybody who, you know, influenced me as into this new black mentality, or who I idolized to try to come up, or who influenced me, other than he did say his parents, but we'll get into that. And he's not going to point to anybody. So he's taking this on himself, that this is my opinion, this is how I evaluate and everything. Now he said the second part to this, he says, my experience of being black. Now, Pharrell ain't no young kid, man. Pharrell is 41 years old. But his mindset is not like a 41-year-old supposedly be. Yes, I understand that people have different experiences and you grow differently and as you mature. But a person at 41 year old talking the way he's talking, he's not talking of a man who's been 40 years in this country and actually coming from Virginia, who has a long history, you understand what I'm saying? A long battle history. And for you to try to segregate yourself off and to make it that you are different from those who've done so much prior to you, because I'm going to break it down. I'm going to show you, new black, how, let's put your history up versus black. And let's see, you know, who should be shamed of who. You feel what I'm saying? Now, a lot of you are not going to agree with it, but you know, I'm Mr. Blows Your Mind. I'm the whiteologist. So we'll start off early where you can comment, subscribe, dislike, like. You want to elaborate any further? You know what to do. So he says, my experience of being black, 41 years old, which means if you go 41 years back, we're in 2014, you take the 14 off, that'll leave you what? About 27 years back. So take the 27 back off of that 19 of that 2000. Okay, you know he's coming in the 70s, right? Okay, now if not 73, maybe about 73, right? All right, so here's somebody who coming up out of 1973. Okay. Which means by the time the 80s is rolling around, he's only about 8 years old. Being a child and being amongst certain things, sometimes you're not comprehending of all aspects of all the things that are around you. You know what I mean? There's some hidden aspects, even though you might be aware, but you may not be fully comprehending every aspect of everything, right? So we can look at that and say, okay, well, you're only 8 years old then. By the time the 90s rolled around, right, he's about 18, right? So let's look at it from this perspective. If you were not primarily a teenager on up by the time the 80s is rolling around, then you did not see the shift and the change, okay? Because by the time the 90s is rolling around, that, you know, this implementation of this new dichotomy of relationships are starting to now become more public. And so his experience, and based on where he's coming from, see, if you come out of the South compared to coming out of the city, it's a two different old worlds. Coming out of the South, the way the South has already been segregated or segregated off or separate off had already been established long way back. So most of the blacks who are down South, we can't say at this present time, we're talking about going back at the time he was and even before then, due to how the institution of white supremacy, right, and how the South was, blacks had their own section. So you live primarily amongst only your own people, right? So coming up in a particular time, being in the South, the only encounters that you probably dealt with white people, you know what I'm saying, if it's not to and fro, back and forth, you know what I'm saying, in establishments, right? You may have a teacher or so in your school, but primarily, you're only going to be associating with your own people. This is what the new blacks don't understand. See, and somebody at this age, just because his experience has severed him off, he feels like he can catapult himself and put himself in the light to say that this is the new thinking. You ain't no child, my man. You actually, damn near, could be a grandfather. So why are you talking like a damn child? He's talking like a child. My experience of being black. Well, of course, that's your experience, but does that only entail only you? What about historically as a whole? Not just individually. As people of color, we cannot be just individual people. That's been our problem. The problem has been you all want to be individual, take care of just mine and not worry about those around me. Well, that's the reason why we're in the condition we in, is because we never connected and unified and say, you know what? If I'm teaching just my children, right, and you raising your children up, and you instilling in them morals, you understand, and giving them good, trying to, you know, have them to be logical thinkers with good common sense, but everything else around them is not doing that. They're not teaching. They're not inculcating. They're not, you know, promoting good nature, good heartedness. What's going to eventually happen to your children? See, you can't isolate and just put yourself. That's why they flight it out. See, when the white people flight it out, when they try to go 1954, because I'm going to make that the marking period for you new blacks. This is the beginning of the new black, is 1954. That is the beginning of it. And the reason why I say 1954 is because when you look at it historically, this is where you're trying to integrate the schools. Prior to that, we was doing what we was doing. We was all congregating, communizing with each other. Teach one, reach one. You understand? Take care. All the whole nine, right? But this 1954, huh? These people that's coming up out of, and then this 1954 about this whole thing, and then end up coming with Martin and all this other stuff, right? This whole integration and all this stuff, right? This is what they talking about. These are these new blacks. These are the ones that felt like if we become educated, that if we become educated, we can get rid of this stuff that is causing us all these problems. So his lack of experience, he don't really know huh? Or he pretending to act like he don't know what is the ills of this nation. And so I'm saying that you have a responsibility as an individual, not just you per se, any of y'all, all of y'all who call yourself New Black, who consider yourself to be educated, successful, and got status. You try to rid yourself from those who struggle, who are still permeated from what done happened in the past, and continue to still be afflicted by it. And I'm going to break down what this brother, I'm going to give him the pass to say. But he's lacking in experience because he's 41 years old and he acting as if he don't even understand what is going on or what has gone on in this country and continues to go on is just being masked. Huh? It's like saying, for instance, if you came over to my house and I had a coffee table that was made of shit, and it done solid, became solid, and hard, and the stench of it is not really as strong, it just has a little weak way, like, ooh, is that shit? No, that's a coffee table. No, but is it made out of shit? I'm like, nah, that's a coffee table. See, I can mask it all day long and tell you it's a coffee table, and I can sit your drinks on it, you understand? Put a little cloth over it, you know what I'm saying? But if you sit there and evaluate it and look at it and say, man, I know shit when I see shit. No, they say, nah, that's a coffee table. You feel what I'm saying? This is the mentality, is what they're acting as if like they don't see the shit. You get what I'm saying? So his experience of 41 years old and still talking about how my mama and them raised me. You grown now. Huh? You grown. You ain't no child anymore. You grown man. But your mentality is showing that you have not matured. You have not grown yet. So he goes on, and then if you look at what he says at the beginning of that sentence, he says, my, individually, my experience. Not we as a black people collectively. No, no one's going to voice out for that. But if I individualize it and then make it about my experience, I can exclude a lot of that. So I appease white folks. That's why I say my or I. You feel what I'm saying? Because I isolate everybody else and I can say based on my experience only, guess what? I haven't gone through any of that stuff and I don't understand why they're the way they are. But you act like you don't know the history. You come from a place of Virginia. You mean you don't know the history of Virginia? Yeah, right. 3, he says, I love what I do. I love who I am. I love what I do. What do you really do? Huh? What do you do? You're making music, right? Okay. What gave you that? That's your passion. No one is trying to take away your passion. But in that love that you have and what you have now become from that, and those who support what you do, and those who you become an icon, a public figure, those who are in those conditions, who are looking for places to see something positive. Hold on one second. So you become that beacon. You become that light to those who are so-called in the mind's eye of the New Black, who are being detrimented through the web and the muck and the mire, who are stuck in the past. So you feel like you don't have any obligation to those people, but this is your love, and this is where you have grown out of your love. Huh? And you love who I am. Who are you? If you're saying New Black, how can you associate and love thyself when you actually acting as if you don't know thyself? You don't know thyself. At least that's the way you acting. So, are you lying? I love who I am? No, you love who you have made your mentality as we'll find out later. You love who you have made yourself to think that who you are, and you want to separate yourself. Huh? And you kind of, well, we'll get to that. So he says, and I make no excuses for what I look like and what that means to me. Well, he has I twice and me. All individualness. Nothing collectively. Nothing to do with the community. Nothing to do with the nation. All about me. I. Selfishness. That's what the new gen or the new black is. Selfish. You only thinking of yourself. Prove me wrong. Show me any of you who call yourself that, who are under the prescription of that. And do you take your talent, your gift, and do you not take it out of there? You're no different than the white man. When the white man goes into Africa and then he undermines the country and takes the resources out of the country, then they show you the pictures of the people and look at the detriment of the people, and you say that, well, they don't want anything. They're making excuses that somebody is taking it. And see, I don't look at it that way. I mean, I don't make any excuses that they're stealing it and they're robbing us and they're keeping us from prospering. Yeah. You see what I'm saying? So, I make no excuses. See, no excuses is talking about old black, as they put it, right? Old black sit around and complain and got excuses why we're in this condition. And because of my lack of experience, I can't understand why you guys are complaining. Everything is fine. I got white girls, and I get to eat in the fine restaurants, and I went to school. I became educated. I'm going to tell you something about this old so-called education that you sit down here and you hold in such high esteem as it really means something. Huh? Y'all like playing that game. You like trying to act as if like, well, you know what I'm saying? Well, I'm not ignorant. Ignorant just means people who are not privy or who are not learned on the things that you consider yourself to be learned in. And the only thing that you truly know is about how to work that job that where you go to for 9 to 5 every damn day. But let's keep going on. And it says, he makes no excuses for what I look like. What? True black folks don't complain about what they look like. I'm going to say that again. True black folks don't complain about what they look like. You accept the fact who you are, right? And the people that you seem to be making reference to is white folks. Who makes you feel uncomfortable in your own skin. They the ones tell you that black is not beautiful. They the ones who permeate the mind where you have children who will pick the black doll as ugly and the white doll pretty. Huh? So who are you talking to about for what I look like and what that means to me? And what that means to you is what? That I'm different from them. Can't you see? I wear a damn cowman hat or a damn state trooper hat or a Dudley Do-Right ass hat. You know what I'm saying? I try to distinguish myself to make myself to be different from them. Who tries to distinguish himself from something is trying to hide from what they're trying to distinguish themselves from. Isn't that what they do? You're trying to distinguish yourself from something that you derived out of. Without them, you don't even exist. And so you try to make a distinction, a stiff arm. So anybody, they're not to show any brilliance in those who are in opposition to them. And if they do, if you do become brilliant, or an expert in something, Doesn't the system do whatever it can to try to get you to amalgamate into their system? And that's what you do. You take your talent and you take that gift and you give it to somebody else to keep upholding up their damn system. You new blacks are funny to me. Now, very funny to me. So you use your mind. I use my mind as if black people don't use their mind. They don't think, but we think. They don't think. They're just emotional. Doesn't that sound white? Black people don't think? If black people didn't think, then they couldn't become emotional. What makes you emotional? Because you thought about something and it made you get pissed off about it. You feel what I'm saying? So you use your mind for my opportunity. Tell me somebody who don't want something. Tell me somebody who don't want something, especially when we're talking about black people. Black people are always in need and always seeking for opportunity. But the criterion that they set for those opportunities, based on what they've given, a lot of us cannot meet those criteriums. See, if you come from these so-called public school systems, and they're giving you 19th century education in a 21st century world, and you feel like you was an A student there, and then when you get to find out when you go somewhere else that you own nothing but a damn CD student. You feel what I'm saying? But no, no, no. That's an excuse. That has no truth in it. You're making that up. Well, how come if I'm making that up that majority of you new schoolers, and I can't say all of you, but we're going to say who our generation of new school, new black to the other new black. We're going to say y'all got about three generations of new blacks. Because again, remember, I'm starting you at 1954. We are now 2014. That's about, what, 60 years? 20 years is a generation. That's three generations, right? You got about three generations of new blacks, right? And so, your little minute three generation versus the 18 to 15 generations, and you have the nerve. And I've looked at a lot of these different videos, and they're in there, and they're trying to defend it. And all the thing they keep talking about is because we're educated, because we want to be educated, we want to be successful, and we want to have status. You don't even understand. You're trying to be white. You're trying to be white. Now, I'm not telling you that education has anything to do with being white. I'm not saying being successful has to do with anything being white. And I ain't talking about status. But what I'm saying is, just because you have all those, does it mean that you are better than the rest of your people? Aren't you supposed to take that which you have acquired and bring it to the less unfortunates and to help them to raise up so that they also too can pull themselves up by them bootstraps? Or what do? Is that you go on and you go on and then you segregate yourself and you move out and you get up under the company of these other folks and you turn your blind eye to everybody else. So those are the opportunities that old black, as y'all put it, has. Because all the good, gifted, talented people leave amongst them. So the excuses that those black people got, this is one of them. Where the hell are y'all at? Oh no, we're not going to live down there because you guys are down there killing and you got drugs and you get... Put it together, smart ass. Y'all so goddamn smart. Why is it that way the way it is? Y'all so goddamn smart. You know it all. You're the new black. Tell us why the drugs are in the community. Tell us why the guns are in the community. Tell us why black people are killing black people. Tell us why that the fatherless homes are permeated in those areas. Tell us why the women are out there who are maybe tricking and selling themselves. Tell us why, new black, turning a blind eye, aren't you? Those are the opportunities that they have. He goes on and says, I'm not looking for anyone to help because of my skin color. I don't see my skin color. What? I'm not looking for anyone to help, anyone's help. See, that's a cliche. Black people always looking for a handout, somebody to help them, some kind of assisted program. You see, y'all, you know, y'all buy into all that nonsense and you don't do no real research because you don't care, because you don't, you just looking and you just trying, you all, see, I've seen a video where a brother was talking about, people talking about, I be talking white. No. Articulation and talking white is two different things. Huh? For those, even you hear me, you may say that I'm ignorant or that I am not articulate, but guess what? I do not change the treble in my voice, nor the bass, in front of you, nor in white folks. I'm going to say that again. I do not change the treble, nor the bass in my voice, whether I'm in front of you or in front of white folks. You feel what I'm saying? So when people say that you're talking white, they're saying you have stripped the natural essence of who you are, trying to accommodate yourself so that you can sound the pleasing, like say odorous to scent. The sound is pleasing to the ear of the white person to make you feel non-threatening. Do I need to say that again? That the sound that comes out of your mouth when you are articulating the so-called English vernacular, right? You speak in a way that comes across soothing to the white man's ear to make him feel comfortable that you're not threatening to him. If I come to him and I'm saying what I'm saying in the tonnage and I'm saying, he said I'm yelling at him. I tell them all the time, you don't even know me. How do you know how I speak? No, because it's coming out with such power and such veracity and with such truth that you can't take it. So when you say, I'm not looking for any help, you're just going on with the bullshit ass cliches that black people are always looking for a damn handout. And because of my skin color, who in this right day and age and at 40 years old is still talking about skin color? Huh? At this point and stage of your life, this shouldn't even be part of the conversation. My skin color? I don't see my skin color as some affliction. Real black folks don't say it's my skin color because of my affliction. I'm black, and black has nothing to do with skin color. You feel what I'm saying? Black got to do with your essence, your soul, your heart, your mind, not your skin color. Let me tell you something. There's a lot of people with black skin that ain't your kin. You feel what I'm saying? I'm going to say that again. There's a lot of black folks who got black skin who ain't your kin. And this is what new black is showing us. You got the same skin, but you ain't our kin. You validating my point. So he goes on and says about his some affliction. Only the people who think that black skin is an affliction to them is because you are being permeated with the white psyche telling you that white is right, white is beautiful, and that white is everything, and you are buying in, you are conflicting within yourself, trying to make that white and try to mask or try to devalue yourself to make that become real. That's what you're doing. Real black folks don't sit around talking about I'm afflicted because of my black skin. This is someone who sits down and meditates on why is it that white people are not accepting me because of my skin color. Well, if you are afflicted at 40 years old and talking about you're afflicted, or you even make that affliction of my skin, means you, my friend, have not even done any studying on about your blackness. Because once you realize and come to find out what melanin is, daddy, you said, matter of fact, you could have changed that, right? You could have said, I don't see my blackness as some affliction because I know what melanin is. Huh? You could have offset it that praising, holding up your blackness, but you say, I don't see my skin color as some affliction. See, you could have used a technical term to show that the white skin really wants your skin, and I shouldn't. And so the affliction ain't on black people. The affliction's on white people. White people are afflicted that they don't have melanin. Don't you see why they making all this melatonin, and they got to go outside with suntan and sunscreen and high pH or whatever the hell that shit is they using? But you got black people today. The new blacks are going in the store. They're putting it on too. Because I'm getting sunburned. Guess why? Your essence ain't black. You're a new black. New black got no protection. You're going to need it. Because you got no protection. So he goes on and he says, my skin color is some affliction or something that holds me back in the world. Wait a minute. Does my black skin hold me back in the world, or is there a white supremacy system that been holding our people back? See, you confused. You are strictly confused. And you new blacks who think that black people sit around and say, well, you know what? If I wasn't black, this wouldn't be happening to you. My skin would see you hate. That's self-hatred. To sit down and talk about my skin is afflicting me is only when we did not know any better. Now that you are in the age where you can know, and there's plenty of information out here for you to get, and now to now get in there and delve into that stuff and dig for it and find out why they really hate you, you should be sitting there saying that. You should say, that shouldn't even be part of the conversation, because you know why they're doing what they're doing. So you're putting that back on the people who still talk like that because they have not come to the realization who they are. Okay? They haven't come to the realization of who they are yet. That's where you come in, new black. You're supposed to come in with your so-called education and your success and your status, and you should say, young brothers, black is beautiful. Black is the melanin. This is the key to life, and melanin is what they're in search of. This is what they're doing, and this is what they're going around the world trying to get it to tan, because ours is beautiful. That's not what you're doing. You're saying, oh, they sick because they're sitting there talking about because I'm black. Well, is it true that the reason why they're being held back and the reason why they was enslaved and all that is because they were black? Get real, boy. And he says he said, I'm proud of my skin color. Really? Really. At the end of the day, anything that I do, I celebrate who I am. And celebrate what my mom and dad made. And that is now a way of looking. Now, and that is, I don't know, what do you say? And that is how, in, I don't know what the hell he said. A way of looking my life. Okay. I have to go back and look at that part because that only makes sense. And I wrote that down, what he said. But he said that he give reverence. To his mother and dad. Well, why would you not? Without them, see, this is the same thing I'm talking about. You connect your mom and dad, because they taught you the new black. But your mom and dad came from old blacks, and old blacks before that, and old blacks before then. So somebody decided to cut that off. right? Just cut that off. You don't need that. So celebrating yourself. I mean, come on, man. Please. Can I speak to a whole entire culture? No, I can't. That's y'all problem. Y'all feel that how the media portrays you, how the imagery on TV affects and permeates, that you have no responsibility to those people whom you say are detrimental, and you can be some influential light to them, and you feel like I don't have no obligation to them. That's New Black's mentality. That's your whole mentality. Separate myself from y'all because, one, socially you're not where you are, educationally you're not where I am, and you're not trying to obtain or trying to achieve where I want to be. So I'm going to disassociate you and cut you off, and the hell be with you. Let the white man do what he wants to you, because guess what? He accepts me. I am no burden to him. Now, this other part says the New Black doesn't blame other races for our issue. Doesn't blame. Black people blame is what you got to ask yourself is it legitimate? Is black folks blaming European whites in this nation? Is it legitimate? You New Blacks are funny. We don't blame other races for our issue because you're trying to sleep with them. You're trying to associate with them and you're trying to be them. That's why you don't blame. How can you be around them saying that and being friends with them? Do you see the residuals of history? And this, you say, well, I don't blame. Yeah, you don't have to blame them. You keep on. Y'all keep on. The New Black, he says, the New Blacks dream and realize that it is not a pigmentation, it's a mentality. Dreams? This reality, son. Reality. Dreams is what Martin told you. See, that's what Martin said. He said a dream. See, when you're dealing with dream, you're dealing in a psychosis of non-reality. You're making your fantasy in your sleep, and you can be and do whatever you want. But when you come into this reality of where we at, there are bounds. There are boundaries. There are lines. You understand? That cannot be crossed. No matter what you say. You feel what I'm saying? I'm not saying that that is what holds me. I'm saying this is a system that is designed to do that. And you and those like you are not ever going to blow that up. And you know why I can say that? Because most of y'all consider yourself to be Christians. If you're reading your book said that God got to come to change it. So what makes you think you're going to change it? Then otherwise, then the book you're reading ain't true, is it? Now, which one is it? Did the Bible tell you that God got to come? Because they're going to get to the point that they're going to be so, you know, horrendous that God himself has to step in and stop it. So what makes y'all think that y'all going to change something? What makes that book have to be a lie now that says that this, the people who have done the affliction, who have caused the damage, is never going to stop it. And God would have to intervene in it. See, you're fooling yourself. Dreams. And you realize that it's not a pigmentation, it's a mentality. What mentality? So if you let's say, how can I say this? So, are we saying that if I denounce my pigmentation, which means to denounce my blackness, and putting my mind what is acceptable to the system. Then he said, either it's gonna work for you or it's gonna work against you. So guess what? It can work either way, right? So is it true what you're saying? If you denounce your pigmentation, as you say, it's not about my pigmentation, I realize that it's not a pigmentation, it's a mentality, meaning my mindset, the way that I think. But who's the one making you not to love yourself is the question. Why is loving your pigmentation wrong? Why is being black wrong? And so to not have love for that, to go into your mind and to denounce it, is okay with you. And then you says, the last part says, and you got to pick a side you're going to be on. That reminds me of Dave Chappelle, the race draft. Remember that? You want to get who would most of you new blacks? See, this is the way it needs to be done. If the new blacks could have a race draft, huh? Who would you want to get picked by? Because you sure don't want the black folks picking you. So who do you really want to pick you up? Boy, y'all's a mess. Y'all is a real mess. I'm sorry y'all mess, man. But let me tell you something. I'm going to end this off. There was a brother named Bobby E. Wright, a PhD, right? This brother here got a PhD. So he was educated. Successful because he had his job as a professor and he had a status that he was a professor. So listen up, new black. He says, in a bullfight, there comes a time when after being brutalized while making innumerable charges at the movement of a cape, the bull finally turns and faces his adversary with the only movement being his heaving bloody side. It is believed that for the first time he really sees the matador, and this final confrontation is known as the moment of truth. For the bull, this moment comes too late. The experience of black people all over the world presents an analogous situation. For hundreds of years, they have been charging at that banner that are held by the European whites, matadors. Those banners have been represented by concepts such as democracy, capitalism, Marxism, religion, and education. And they remain constant as long as blacks were assets. However, with technology and worldwide industrialization on the rampage, resulting in a further exploitation of African resources, which in turn produces and increases in Africa blacks' national consciousness, blacks are now a threat and a liability to the white race, and the banner held by the matador represents only one concept, genocide. As a consequence, the major research that white scientists are involved with today is genocidal in nature. Nuclear warfare, population control, medication control, genetic engineering, psychosurgery, electrical stimulation of the brain, and the highly complex science of behavioral technology. Therefore, it is indeed black moment of truth, and it is time for them to look at the manador. See, and that's what the new blacks do. See, you say that the old blacks are sitting there as the bull who's looking at the manador's cape, right? This is the new black. The new black is only looking at the cape, right? He sees the cape and he says, well, there's nothing by the cape. It's just the cape. The cape can't do any harm to you. But yet, it seems like every time I'm trying to advance and achieve, I seem to be getting hurt all the time. So it can't be that. But the old blacks are saying, hey, behind the cape is a goddamn man stabbing you. And the new black is like, ain't no man back there. It's just a damn cape. And the old blacks keep saying, there's a fucking man behind there with a sword and he's stabbing your ass. Every time you're trying to achieve, he's trying to kill your ass. And the new black is like, y'all crazy. Oh, you want to make excuses. You want to say that somebody else is doing something and we can see. If you put your mind like me and just say it's just a damn cave, guess what would happen? I don't understand where you're coming from. Then that moment of truth, when his ass finally feels that his energy is falling and he can't achieve anymore, and then white people don't want you anymore and they're throwing your ass away, and then you're going to look at that moment of truth and that moment is going to hit you in the back of your goddamn mind. Black people were right all along. This is Mr. Blows Your Mind. Come on, another thought-provoking topic. You new blacks, I got them in my family too. My children, matter of fact. And let me tell you something. Y'all go ahead and keep playing that game with this, oh, I'm educated and I'm successful and I'm status and look at you, you're wallowing in history and you're wallowing in the fact that what somebody did and you want to sit around and you want to blame other people. You keep on, because that moment of truth going to come for you. And when it do, and you already settled your tie with the blacks.
What you laughing at, Kid Rock?
Oh, man, don't hate on me just because you're a sellout.
I didn't hear that. What was that?
You heard me, bougie Bantam.
You got the black girlfriend, you got the pimped out ride, and I'm a sellout? Man, you ain't nothing but a minstrel show turned on its ear. Al Jolson in a boo-boo hat, black face for the new millennium.
Hey, man, you think you could hook me up with your black girlfriend, white girlfriend?
Oh, yeah. Higher education. How come the only thing you talk about is me?
Because you don't belong here. The white barbershop is uptown.
You know what I think? You wish you were me. Wish you had my fly-ass girlfriend and my pimped-out ride. Man, you even wish you had my clothes, my style, my walk. Why you think my fly-ass girl ain't with you? Because your little bitch-ass can't compete.
Oh, I got news for you, white boy. You're not black.
Timmy, I'm blacker than you. And what's messed up is in your best day, you could never be me.
Me?
Marvin Gaye.
You gonna take that?
I was born in this time to never be free. Born in this time to never be free. Waiting all my time for freedom. Now it's too far up ahead of me.